What I thought we could do is start out with a brief set of introductions. I'm Ed Whitfield. I'm gonna tell you a little bit more about me in a minute, but what I thought we could do is quickly run around the room, get some sense of who's here by having everyone give their name, a place, and a word that they think about when they think about reparations. Is that okay? Now, some of us I know from organizations that are so important to us that we'd like to list them to, and so that's okay if you do it really fast. But I want to do it so that everybody gets to speak on it and we don't take a lot of time with it, and then we roll. So, is that okay? Did everybody go? Okay. I'm Ed Whitfield from originally from Little Rock, Arkansas, but I live in North Carolina now, and I mainly think about opportunities to be productive. So I cheated. I didn't use one word. But I'm gonna cheat more because I didn't chance to do this session today. What I wanted to warn you all as we do this is that. You're in the right place. What I wanted to warn you all is that I am an iconoclast and an autodidact, which means that I've learned almost nothing of any use in any of the various schools I attended. So all this stuff is something I learned in the street somewhere or someplace else. I also take great store in not getting too tightly connected with the prevailing wisdom and the way people normally think about stuff, because if the prevailing wisdom was wise at all, then we'd be a whole lot better off than we are. So a lot of it is not that much. So I'm going to ask you, what I want you to do in the session is a number of things. One is I want you to be challenged. Two, I want you to speak up. And three, I want you to let me get through this presentation. Because we could get so challenged and speak up that we all kind of stop. And just let me get through this one. And I think that there's two kinds of things that I won't be saying today. Well, I won't be saying at a given point when you might want to speak up. One is something I'm going to get to a little later. And there's something else, there are other things that are kind of off the path. And so if you let me, I'll tell you that it's one or the other of those if we're going to keep going. Or if not, it may be an incredible contribution to the dialogue and something we need. One of the things I want to say about what we're doing in general is that this is the process of co-creating knowledge. I think that every time we have a chance to dialogue and think together, we have the chance to co-create something that's bigger than what any of those of us thought. So I plan to leave here knowing a lot more than I did when I came in, except I've been thinking about it really, really hard for a long time. And so, you know, bear with me. I want you to hear some things that you might have heard or hear them in a slightly different way. Anybody here ever heard of David Bohm, the physicist? He was somebody that Einstein once thought of as possibly his successor. But one of the things David Bohm said that really impressed me, has helped me think about things, is he said the way to understand something deeply is to try to understand the differences between things that seem the same and the sameness and things that seem different. I thought about it, wow, this is deep. I mean, it really does give you a framework, a dynamic framework, almost always challenging when you're thinking about it. Because when you think, well, that's the same as that, then you go say, but it's different in these ways. But then that difference is really, and it gives you a really, really kind of ongoing, challenging way to think about things. You can come on in there, many seats. So, who's heard of the Chicago torture settlement? One of the things that people are talking about now is the reparations kind of issue. How about the what happened with the Japanese who were interned during World War II? Reparations again got paid. Germany as it related to Jewish people who had been in and involved in damage by German war efforts. Reparations, right? Who here knows the relationship between France and Haiti on reparations? Who was it?
France sued Haiti or took money from Haiti for the revolution and ending slavery because of the debts they owed for losing property.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, that's amazing. It's sick. It's a shameful period of history. And particularly when we realize that Haiti was actually paying on that debt up until fairly recently. And it is one of the things that has helped bankrupt. It's part of the punishment, the collective punishment that the Haitians have had for having been the first independent republic in the West, first independent republic. They did it with slavery when the rest of these folks were talking about democracy and lying through their teeth. In recent years, Ta-Nehisi Coates has written a very, very interesting article a lot of people read in The Nation. Anybody here read that article?
Mm-hmm.
Many. Okay. Has anybody heard of the book written by Randall Robertson called, what's the name of it?
The Debt.
The Debt. Very good. Excellent. Anybody else read that yet? I highly recommend it. Very clear, insightful, passionate argument of a short book in its form that really talks about the role that slavery played in the development of the nation. Two other books I want to recommend highly to people as we're starting to think about this. One is by Edward Baptist. Edward Baptist is a historian, teaches at Cornell University. He just wrote a book called The Half Has Never Been Told. Anyone heard of that book? I highly recommend it. It is one of the most incredible histories of slavery, economic histories of slavery that I've ever looked at. And another thing by an author that I plan to read a lot more of is Gerald Horn. Gerald Horn is a historian, African-American historian at the University of Houston who wrote a book. One of his recent books is The Counter-Revolution of 1776 that analyzes the whole American Revolutionary period as largely being an effort on the part of the colonies to prevent the British from abolishing slavery out of the incredible amount of profit that slavery was generating for the entire colonies, not just Southern slave states. Part of what Baptist is able to establish in his book is that the profitability of slavery ended up generating both huge amounts of money for all of capital formations in the United States, as well as Europe, when slaves themselves were securitized. Anybody know what that means? When I say slaves themselves were securitized, I mean slaves were mortgaged. Then you could borrow money against the mortgage value of your slave property. And then the banks that held those mortgages would end up selling bonds in Europe at guaranteed and fixed interest rates that were guaranteed by the states, but basically supported by the labor, the capacity of slaves to pick cotton, which was something that was ever increasing on the basis of something called the pushing system. So what the pushing system was a system of torture, and it was a system of torture and accounting. It basically led people to keep very, very accurate records on the amount of cotton production that each slave was able to do, so that the next day they were called upon to do at least as much and maybe more, or they would be tortured, they would be beaten. There was a lead person out in front who was picked to be one of the fastest pickers, and if anybody caught them, he would get beat, and if he ran off and left everybody, they would get beat. So every day, somebody was getting beaten. And this method of increasing productivity led to increases in productivity that exceeded the increases in textile productivity in Europe during the same period, which were based on changes in machinery and the development of new technology. This was based on torture of people. And the sums of money that were produced basically put into motion the whole economic and financial systems that the new world, the modern world of Europe and America was built on. So we're not talking just about lost wages, which is one of the kind of calculations that some people would want to make about. We're talking about the creation of a vast empire of finance on the roots of chattel slavery, on the idea of converting humans into human capital. Anybody know what that would mean? By human capital, I mean just like you capitalize the rent that you can collect off a piece of property in order to set its price, they were capitalizing the value of the cotton that was produced. In other words, you divided by the expected rate of return that you want on your investment, and that's how you set the price of a slave. And so slaves were measured in hands. One hand was a prime field hand. There were some people who were particularly good that might even be worth a hand and a half. There were some people who were younger or smaller or weak in condition that might sell as a half hand. So this was a unit of measure. So, you know, when I thought about this thing about hands, I was in a workshop just yesterday where a young lady from Ethiopia was saying, we were talking about food. She said, when I think about my mother, I think about my mother's hands, because everything that she touched tasted like life. All right? So I like that story about hands. Mm-hmm. But the hands that are reduced to simply how fast you can pick cotton out of a bowl and put it in a bag and weigh it at the end of every day, that measurement of people completely reduces and damages the full humanity of people, so that their measure was nothing but the capitalized value of their labor power. And at a point when cotton is no longer king, and when even the factories that people ran off to after the closing down of that kind of agriculture are closed down, and even the houses, the people who used to, the domestic houses are being foreclosed, what now is the value of these Africans who were brought here as slaves? Well, evidently you can call them a thug and the value is nothing, shoot them down in the street. That's what the world we live in now. But it again is rooted in the slave system, deeply rooted in the slave system. Okay, what I want us to do is something that it should be kind of fun. What do you all think about when you hear 40 acres on a mule? What's that about? 40 acres on a mule was a form of reparation. You know who proposed it and where it came from?
Reconstruction, right?
Yeah. Actually, right at the ending of the Civil War, before Reconstruction was in full swing, General Sherman issued something called Special Field Order Number 15. He did this on January 16th, 1865. I guess that was, 2 weeks after the Emancipation Proclamation. He issued special field orders. And what it called upon was the division of a lot of property, a lot of the confiscated property in the South, and division of it into 40-acre plots, and the issuance of, you know, other tools and equipment needed to make this work. Anybody have any idea how big 40 acres is? What's a rough, is it 1 million square feet? Is it more than that, less than that?
No.
40 acres, surprisingly enough, is about 1.75 million square feet. 40 acres is basically an area that's 1/4 mile wide and 1/4 mile deep. It's 1,742,400 square feet. It's about 900,000 square yards. It's big. It's like taking 4 football fields, putting them end to end, that wide, that's 400 yards, and another 4 football fields deep. It's a good little chunk of land. Way too much to build a house on it, you know, to do something. Russell Simmons, genius that he is, came up with a suggestion that in this day and time, rather than talk about 40 acres on a mule, we ought to be talking about 40 acres on a Bentley. And I'm going, you missed the point. What's the difference between a mule and a Bentley? No, I mean, for real.
Mules can work the land.
Huh?
The mule's transportation to work the land.
The mule can work the land. So consequently, a mule is actually able to help you raise the food that you're going to feed the mule. Mule feed himself. Has anyone ever seen a Bentley that would feed itself? So here we go from people having talked about a production unit, something that would give them an opportunity to be independent. I heard some of the answers that had to do with independence and self-reliance, and they have gotten it confused with a consumption unit, which just gives you a way to spend some more money. Because once you get a Bentley, you're going to have to be out buying some gas.
Yes.
It's not even intended to be fuel efficient. You know what I mean? Okay. And then you got to put the bling on it and stuff, and by the time you get through kind of fully dressing your Bentley, you spend a bunch of money. But so here it was that people during the early time, as slavery was coming to an end, were talking about developing productive units, and somehow it has slipped into being a discussion around how we're going to divide things up for consumption. So one of the things I want us to do while we're here is to kind of reimagine. One of the things that's really cool about the Allied Media Conference is the way it treats the whole idea of imagination. So what I wanted to do is use our imaginations to together kind of co-create an oppressive economic system. The reason why is because I think that as we go through creating it together, it gives us a way to feel what it is and talk about what it ought to be. And so let's try it. Okay? So, this area right over here, that part of it, let's think of that as a commons. We need a bunch of folk over in this commons because, again, I'm starting from an orientation that in the beginning, all we had was a big ball of dirt. It was a big, wet ball of dirt floating around out in space with the sun shining on it. And I'm not talking about all the way to the very beginning when it was still steaming and there was no life. I'm talking about after the primordial ooze or whatever it was and the mold and the fungi and stuff started to grow. But it's a big wet ball of dirt nevertheless. Okay, that's what we started with. That was all we had, but we all had it, right? That was all we needed. What can you do with a ball of dirt? Can you live on it? Gave us a place to stand. It gave us fruit to pick off the existing trees. It gave us existing animals to chase around and chase down and eat if we could, or be eaten by them. The cycle of life goes on, whichever side you're on. But that's what it was, big ball of dirt. After a certain point, we were able to take our labor and convert parts of that ball of dirt into things that had even more values. We built cities and towns and transportation systems and network theories and science and technology and education. All of this was a product of our labor, and so I want to talk about that as our blood. And all of the stuff that we made, which was really nothing but now the embodiment of our labor on things we did while on this ball of dirt, let's call those bones. Let's think of that as dead labor. So we got blood, bones, and dirt. That's all it is. But let's go back early when it was mainly just dirt. So I need some people up here. We're going to be in the commons. What will we do in the commons together? What will we do on this? Come on. Don't everybody be shy one time. We can shout later. What will we do in the commons? Will we hunt? Why not? Somebody's around hunting, running around. Will we grow potatoes?
Yes.
All right, somebody. Come on, somebody, grow some potatoes. Will we try to plant rice? Yeah, why not? We'll pick grass and grains and stuff. So in the commons, there was this common activity where people were meeting human needs, right? Because the first main human need would have been for food. And at some point, we got embarrassed enough around each other, or even some cold area like Detroit, where clothing was actually a necessity. And people started using the abundance of nature to create clothing. And at some point, we decided that we could take mud together out of the ground and stack it up into bricks, and we could build structures. And at some point, we decided that we could take trees and cut them down and use them to build houses, or chairs or furniture to go inside the structure. So at some point, we decided to do all of this. And so now all of these new things that we've created, part of them go to meeting our immediate needs, and the rest is what?
Surplus.
Surplus, exactly. Why is surplus important? What do we use surplus for?
It's cold.
Huh? Not early on. Early on, the idea of selling your surplus was probably, you would probably never drink. This is in the early, early beginning. Before
security.
You could conceivably do that, but mainly
surplus was a form of security. Mm-hmm. In other words, surplus is what secured the good weather this year against the bad weather that's coming, mm-hmm. right? Surplus was what allowed you to eventually create a leisure class of people who didn't actually do all this work, who did other things that enhanced the quality of life. So you were able to pay for the priests out of the surplus. You were able to pay for teachers out of the surplus. If you had teachers who were different from the people that actually did the work, it probably developed later. But the surplus, and you were able to store it up for hard times. So you were able to build big buildings and monuments. You built the pyramids out of the surplus. In other words, that everything extra that you did, all of the things that we look back and talk about as the development, improvement of civilization and life, are the things that came out of the surplus, which at the first, in the beginning, was produced by blood on dirt, right? So now, the surplus becomes part of this pile of bones. So the surplus becomes part of the dead labor, which was produced by living labor acting on earth. Am I making sense?
Yeah.
Now, I'm gonna tell you a reason why, even later when we're talking about this, I'm not going to use the word capital very much, but I will talk about means of production. That one of the things that we would do with surplus was use it to develop, instead of chopping at the dirt with a stick, we would develop a piece of metal, and we would learn how to work metal and have iron-tipped plows. We would also use surplus probably to develop weapons that made it easier to chase down animals and such. So the surplus are the things that made life easier. Developing the quality of life required less and less hours of people's labor in order to produce the food that they needed, and produce a class, a beginnings of classes, beginnings of class structures, where now not everybody is engaged directly in production. So there are some non-productive classes. Not necessarily exploitative at that point, but non-productive. But then at some point, something does happen that is exploitative. At one point, you all who have worked the land all of this time come to the land that you're planning to work, and you're confronted with somebody who waves something in front of you. So, you can't come here anymore. And what would you say?
What are you talking about?
You say, why? What are you talking about? You can't come here anymore because it's mine. What would you wonder? We had an earth. We had an earth. You worked on it. You got the, and it provided everything you need for life and stuff. And you would want to, like, says who? You want to know the person behind it. What else would you want?
How are you going to eat now?
How are you going to eat? Well, I mean, this is mine. I mean, I guess.
What did you do to get it?
What did I do to get it? Oh, I bought it. you remember that non-productive class of folk that kind of came into being? One of them told me he was the king, and he didn't do any work. He was over there. And I asked him, could I buy it? And he said, yeah. So now it's mine. And you ask, what are you going to do to eat? I tell you what, I'll make a deal with you. I'll let you continue to work on the land and eat, and you can have a little of what you make so that you can eat. But now we're going to do something different with the surplus. Mm. Mm. What will we do with the surplus instead? I get to keep it all. Now, would you all be happy with that? I got a piece of paper. I call it a title. What would you tell me I could take this title and stuff it? Okay. It's like, what would I need in order for this piece of paper to be something that you would have to respect?
Guns.
Exactly right. I would need some violent apparatus standing behind me saying that we will enforce your title. So it is that for that reason that in order to have this oppressive system, that we would need a state apparatus that has an army. An army that's willing to kill y'all. All right? So my guess is that in the early enclosures, the early appropriations of the ball of dirt, the early points when we took this away from the people that had lived it and worked it, that my guess is that in the early point of that, there was a lot of killing that went on. Because people would challenge it. It's like, what do you mean? This land that my family has worked for, my grandparents worked it, their grandparents worked it. They told me stories about how people way before that all worked it. What do you mean we can't have it? And I think that the question would be, well, we're going to kill enough of y'all to know it. Now, But in order for the state apparatus not to have to constantly be killing folks, I need a few more people. I need some buffers. I need some folks who will protect me. Because while I have title and ownership and stuff, I want y'all to be teachers, and I want y'all to live a little bit better. Don't worry. I'm going to hook you up. I'm going to break you off a little piece of the surplus. Cool. That's how you will be out. You don't have to work now. You just get a chance to enjoy the benefit of the surplus. They have to keep working. All they get is enough to stay alive. And we take the balance of the surplus, and most of it goes to me, owner. Part of it goes to the state apparatus so they can pay the soldiers. And then I want this whole category of people who are a buffer zone that you all can think at some point you can get to be like these. You know what I'm talking about? You're like, you know, if I work hard and go to school, I'm being able to make it into the buffer zone. They ain't call it the buffer zone, but whatever they call it. Yeah. So I'm gonna be able to hook this up at some point. So I gotta be nice and go ahead and work real hard right now and get my education or whatever it is. This is how oppressive systems are hooked up. So on the one hand, you have the owners who really don't want to constantly be confronting the laboring masses and having to kill them periodically. Because that's not cool, it gets old after a while. And at a certain point, you come up with getting more and more resistance, and quite frankly, if all of the laboring masses could ever decide in one voice, no, this piece of paper wouldn't be worth anything. So I kind of need to convince you that on the one hand, there's some external chains, but the most important ones might be the ones inside your head. The real key to hegemony is the internal in your head chains that make you want to be like them so much that you won't challenge the existence of this whole structure. Now, I want to think about systems. Are systems real? I mean, are they natural? Yes. What do we mean by real and natural? Okay, some people think of natural as the things that were already found in nature. But aren't things, and that's what's really real, and so since the system was created by people, by some evil dude decided they wanted to be the owner and not have to work, that is not real. So. But created things are just as real as the ball of dirt. Because once you build a pyramid, it's real. Once you build a house, it's a construction. It's a social construction. Social labor had to construct. It's real. An automobile is real. Racism is real. It's a social construction. It's a constructed thing, but it's real. Class society is real. It's a constructed thing, but it's real. And the real reality is that all of these things are part of the pile of bones. In other words, included in the bones are machinery, transportation systems. These are all of the things that people made on that ball of dirt. But now parts of them become the structures within which people live and have their own reality, much like the ball of dirt was real. It was real and it was natural, and it's what we found. We didn't create it. We didn't make it. So consequently, none of us ought to be able to claim it. There's no reason why anybody ought to be able to claim the ball of dirt is theirs. And yet we have land surveys that have precisely chopped up the land and drawn lines on it on maps so that we can identify every parcel of it and identify an owner and give them a title and back it up with a state apparatus in order to do it. So, y'all can sit down for now. So we got the early part of our class society. But let's go a little deeper. One of the things that's kind of funny to me is a lot of times you say something about capital, and it's like, well, people need access to capital, somebody say. Oh, yeah, but everybody got some capital. I mean, we got human capital, we got cultural capital. Can somebody start naming all the different kind of capitals people have been talking about lately?
Technology.
What are they called? I mean, put it
at capital. Venture capital.
Huh?
Venture capital.
Venture capital, human capital, cultural capital, spiritual capital, intellectual capital, political capital, social. I mean, have you heard those lists being made?
Yes.
It's like, well, damn, the whole world is made out of nothing but capital. How can you get against the capital? You know what I mean?
And so that's why I talk about bones and blood and dirt, because I want us to actually be able to think about stuff people made on the one hand, stuff that we found, didn't make, and no one should lay claim to, stuff that we made together, quite frankly, and ought to belong to us all. There's some other stuff that we make that ought to belong to us individually. There's no reason that if I go dig in the dirt and get some clay and fashion it into a bowl and build a fire out of sparking rocks or whatever, light and match, whatever I got, and glaze this bowl, there's no reason for that not to be my bowl. There's no reason for me to do that and Morgan come over and take the bowl away. I mean, we get into it on that. So there's a reason for people to have personal stuff. But the whole idea that productive property, that which we all need in order to have opportunities to be productive, that should be individually owned, and the owner is able to set the conditions under which everybody else can use it, it's crazy. So right now in the world today, there's something like 80 billionaires, according to a recent study, that own as much wealth as one half of the population of the planet Earth. The poorest half of the population of the planet Earth owns no more wealth than 80 individuals. That is obscene.
Enough to fit on a bus.
Huh?
Enough to fit on a bus.
Enough to fit on a big bus. That's the thing.
I hear a plan working in the back.
I won't tell. But I want to get back to this whole reparations notion and tell you a quick story from South Africa. This happened during the Truth and Reconciliation period work. This South African whites who had long taken advantage of their privilege of being that buffer stratum between the owners on the one hand, who were also South African whites and European whites, and the laboring masses, were called upon to relinquish their hold on the political machinery. And in the course of doing this, there was this period where they had this truth and reconciliation work. And so some people said, look, we'll give you amnesty if you come and tell the truth about what you've done, because we really want a period of healing. Remember, healing was one of the things that people talked about as one aspect of reparation. And so this older white farmer, he came, and this black guy was there, and they had this confrontation where the older farmer said, yes, you know, I did indeed come to you, and, you know, I took your cows and stuff, and, you know, it was wrong, and I really want to apologize and see how embarrassed and ashamed I was. And the older guy, you know, just was really, his heart was warm by hearing this. He never thought in his lifetime that he would hear an apology for these atrocious things that happened. And so the other guy, you know, having satisfied his thing of telling the truth about what he had done and all that he had taken, decided to walk out the room, and the other guy said, well, wait a minute. And he turns and said, yes. He said, but what about the cow? You still have the cow. Your apology for having stolen the cow doesn't mean all that much to me while you still have the cow. Yeah. One of the things that has happened with slavery and with other oppressive kind of class systems is that this ownership structure has allowed for the accumulation of the bones to remain in access to some communities of people by and large and not available to others. So for all of us, the question of reparations ought to be about asking, well, what about the cow? You know, where's the stuff you stole? And someone, you know, have you ever heard the argument? It's like, how long y'all gonna keep on talking about that? Have you heard that? Why are y'all still talking about something that happened over 170 years ago? Why can't you just move on? It's like, cause you still living in the stuff you stole from us. I'm gonna be ready to move on when I can no longer tell the difference between those communities that were stolen from and those who engaged in the theft. Mm-hmm. When that difference goes away, I don't have to talk about this anymore. So I spent a lot of time thinking about slavery and the 19th century and early 20th century and Jim Crow. Is it because I enjoy thinking about unpleasant things? No, it's because I want to understand right now. Because right now we got communities that are devastated by the fact that people do not have the opportunity to be productive. What does that mean to you? What would be an opportunity to be productive? What would you want to have access to?
Capital.
Exactly right.
A school system that actually taught.
School system actually taught. I'm gonna add on the truth. Some of them teach, but those lies ain't worth knowing. But yeah. What is an opportunity to be productive?
Time when you're not working for somebody else.
Time when you're not working for somebody else. In other words, for when not all of your surplus is being taken again. Do we still live in a world where the surplus of individual producers is being taken by somebody else? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly right. And it's justified by virtue of the fact that we have a profit motive, and businesses are allowed to set maximizing their profit as their main activity. Somebody tell me what profit is. Stolen surplus is what?
A little bit of extra that you get after you produce something.
After you produce something, and after you pay your bills.
For your wage, yeah.
So the profit is the accounting figure you would have left over after you bought all the raw materials. So you're making something. After you bought all the raw materials, after you paid for all of the labor, after you paid for all of the management skills, after you have paid for all of the intellectual property, after you paid all of the rent on structures, after you bought all of the equipment, after you paid all the taxes to the state, after everything, and if y'all can add to that list, there are a few more things that might be on it, but I think that's fairly complete. After everything has been paid, and you notice I said including paying the management, whatever level of supervision and management you think, after you pay for the intellectual property, the idea. So some people want to say, well, no property is what I get from my, no, you pay for the idea. You bought it off of somebody that had good ideas. All you had was property. Okay, so after you pay for everything, the accounting figure that's left over is profit, net profit. So what is it like to have an economic system that is rooted in the idea that the main reason for its existence is to manufacture what's left over after you pay for everything that you needed to pay for? Even after you set aside money for depreciation, after you set aside money for the fact that the equipment and the building will wear out, depreciation is also taken out. So you have the what is left over after everything useful and necessary is profit, and you're trying to maximize that. There's something that you can tell, and it's happened with public education, where some folks will tell you, if you can't measure it, it's not real, and if you don't measure it, it won't grow. So there's what I call it the measurement distortion. That whatever you think is important to measure becomes the way in which things will grow and be distorted. So if indeed the only thing you care anything about is that bottom line, that profit figure that what's left over after you pay for everything that you need to actually pay for, then that's what's going to grow. Because you're going to skimp on everything else. You're going to cut back on the quality of the raw materials. You're going to cut back on the amount of wages you pay. You're going to try to get away with paying as little as possible taxes. Do capitalists do any of this?
Yeah.
We're about to describe the system here. You're going to cut back on everything in order to maximize what's left over after everything has been paid. So you could conceivably be paying higher wages. You could be conceivably doing any number of things differently if the main object for you operating a business is not increasing, maximizing profit. But how many people then think about how crazy that sounds every time they hear someone talk, well, you know, the main thing is the bottom line. I mean, that is just another polite, euphemistic way of expressing that. It's like, that's a sick system. I mean, it really is, because it damages life. So now what we have is that pile of bones, that pile of capital that is dominating living labor and life, and dominating and damaging and extracting from the ball of dirt in order to enhance the pile of bones. What a crazy system. What a crazy system. Okay? So, if we were to fix it, what are some of the things we might want to think about? Let me say a couple other things we want to think about a little bit. Remember when I was talking about ownership? One time we were trying to translate the word democratic ownership into Spanish, and this guy said, well, you know, we don't actually have a phrase democratic ownership in Spanish. He said, because if you talk about ownership, it's like two kinds of ownership. One is ownership as possession, and the other is ownership as title. Like, which one do you mean? And I go, aha.
Think about how important a distinction that is, the distinction between possession and title. What are some of the differences you can think of right quick?
Proximity.
Proximity, exactly right. Where do you have to be to own something by possession? You have to be close to it or far away? You've got to be close to it. Also, scale. How big a thing can you actually possess? Actually possess, not have title to.
What you can carry.
Something limited in size. Maybe even what you could walk around in a day or walk around in 2 days or something. But in other words, there's some sense of scale connected with the idea that you have to possess it. So if I have a land that I have to go work, I can't claim a million acres because there's nothing I can do with a million acres. The only way for me to do anything with a million acres is to exploit somebody else's labor. That's the only, I mean, for real. You can probably actually work 40 acres. Certainly a family was able to work 40 acres. That's why it was a reasonable division. But this, the idea that possession, on the other hand, title, does title have any limit?
No.
No.
So the Queen of Spain could, and in fact did, lay claim to ownership of all of South America. Has anyone ever read any of the accounts of what that actually looked like from the from some contemporaries who were there? They say some dude would climb up on a mountain and take out this piece of paper, which was in Spanish, and read it out loud to people in the crowd who probably couldn't even hear, even if he didn't speak. And he would read it out loud, which was a declaration of the fact that the Queen of Spain now owned all of that and they were her subject. Does that make any sense?
No.
Okay. And once people didn't respond and respected, what did we say was the mechanism by which you enforce title?
Violence.
That's why they had the horsebacks and those metal vests on and stuff and spears and would go down and slaughter people because they didn't respect the title. And they did this because of a temporary mechanical technical advantage that they had. People may or may not know this, but early on, a lot of people were somewhat receptive to the European invaders. They didn't know who they were, and folks, you know, tended to be polite. It's like, you know, welcome, we had enough food here. We had surplus.
Right.
You know?
Make you a plate.
Make yourself at home for a little while. Yeah, you like our pretty shiny trinkets? Yeah, this is gold. We got a gold mine back in there. Gold mine back in the mark. And food and abundance, good weather, beautiful women, strong looking back warriors. We got this covered. Okay, and then viciously slaughtered people. This was the conquest of the Western world. And then after so much slaughter had taken place, then it's like, well, let's take some of the people we conquered over there in Africa, and we just throw them in the bottom of a boat and bring them over there, because some of them ought to be able to grow rice and this kind of weather. They look like, you know, they were farming pretty good over there in Ghana and Nigeria and Angola and Congo. They know something about growing food, and they probably hold up in this heat better than we do. And some of them don't seem to die immediately from malaria like we are. And so that got drug over. So this creation in the Western world of these categories of people based on their relationship to production ended up being the root of the slave system that was part of the root of how capitalism ended up emerging. And it ended up piling up this great big pile of bones. And the reason I want to keep talking about this great big pile of bones, and I don't want to get it confused with intellectual capital and social and spiritual capital and all of that, is because I want us to realize that we need to have full access to the pile of bones. Now, sometimes when I say access to the pile of bones, people think I'm saying something different. They're thinking about distribution of the bones. I'm not talking about passing out bones. I'm not talking about us dividing it up and distributing it. I'm talking about just like Earth itself, which was once here for all of us that we had access to, we need access to the pile of bones. One of the forms of that access we take now is in the form of access to finance. Can somebody tell me the three things that money does in the world? Three attributes of money.
store value, medium of exchange.
Boom, that's 2 out of 3.
Unit of account, yeah.
Yeah, it becomes, money is something that is used to measure value, to store value, and to facilitate exchange. So you got a pile of bones, which is all of the stuff that's been created. And then you have a kind of secondary shadow of the pile of bones, which is also a pile of bones, because again, anything we create is in the bone pile. So now that the bones and the shadow are all over there because we created the shadow as well. What the shadow is the world of finance, which is different from the world of machinery, only, but stuff can pass in and out of it. In other words, if I have enough money, then I'll have access to land. I go rent the land. If I have money, I'll have access to intellectual property. I'll go buy the intellectual property. If I have access to finance, I can go buy the machinery. I could buy the old Chrysler, all of the old Chrysler and GM facilities and start making money. Cars again here, if I had the pile of money, and the pile of bones is that big. It's big enough to do that now, except the limitations of the access are done in such a way that the only people who have good access to it are people whose only interest is in maximizing profit. So you hear, I was thinking the other day, I said, you know, if I had to go back in time and explain to a caveman what a refrigerator was, I think I could do it. I would tell them, you know the meat you get, you know, after a while it goes bad, you can't eat it anymore. Refrigerator is a special box we got, and we hook up to something, and we put the meat in it and last a long time, you see what we eat. I could explain to them what an airplane was. See those birds up there? Well, we can go in the earth and dig up and get certain kind of stuff and put it together and make it into a bird that people make. It's not like a little bird that flaps its wings and it make a lot of noise and stuff and burns too much gas. But it's kind of like a bird. It's like, I can explain it. But you know what I couldn't explain? I couldn't explain what a hedge fund manager was. It's like, okay, you got this guy who buys and sells money. Money? What's money? Well, money is what you use to buy and sell other stuff. Okay, well then why would you buy and sell money? Well, the reason you buy and sell money is hopefully you buy it and you can sell it for more than you bought it for. Okay, well what would you do with the extra if you did that? Well, you would buy some more money. Like, are you crazy? I mean, what the hell is, I mean, really, I can't make it make sense. Can somebody else, how would you explain to somebody that there are people around the world whose main activity in life is buying and selling money and derivatives? Have you ever seen anybody that actually needed a derivative? The only reason they want to buy the derivative is so they can sell it. And the only reason they sell it is so they can get some more money. And what would they use the extra money for? To buy some more derivative. My God. An insane system, right? That you can't explain because so much of the activity in that system is completely phony. It's real because it was a construction. We constructed it. But it's frivolous, foolish, and stupid. So somebody did an analysis not long ago where they said that the key indicator of the disparity between wealth and poverty in a society was the level of financialization that took place in that society. You know what that means? It's the extent to which the society is dominated by economic activity, there's trading and stuff that doesn't make any difference. What do y'all think all the people in New York do? You got two categories of folks in New York. You got a lot of people making a whole bunch of money in these financial services. And then you have layers and layers and layers and layers of people who make a living off of providing services to them and then providing services to others, providing services to them, whatever. And they export food from other parts of New York State and other surrounding areas and stuff. So there's gotta be food and stuff coming in there or people can't live. But that's a minor part of the activity. The biggest part of the activity is the stuff that you couldn't explain to anybody. New York, Hong Kong, Charlotte, North Carolina, I mean, banking and financial centers around the world that are created on this, but what they have is this big pile of bones, which is this finance, trillions of dollars worth of finance that could conceivably and potentially be used to create opportunities to be productive by making some capital available to the public. What would you do if you had enough capital, man? Just give me your biggest dream. But if you had enough capital, don't tell me to buy some more capital. Do something productive that I can explain to a caveman.
You've been manufacturing, food farming.
You would do agriculture productive if you had access to the capital required.
Right.
I want to make solar-powered mass transit vehicles. Mm-hmm. You know, I want us to figure out some way to not pollute anything and build stuff that takes folk around and allow people to move without having to have individual cars and stuff. Because I think it would improve the quality of life. And it would be such a sophisticated big network of it. It would be like, you know, hopping on and off a subway in New York. You can get one anywhere. And it might be some small units that are individually routed through a complex computerized system, and you build all that on basis of the free software. There are things that you could do if you had access to the bones. And where are the bones? They're locked up in financial institutions by a structure and system of ownership that says you can't access them unless you can't access them. We can't. In other words, it's not like, they'll tell you, well, you got to get an education. Has anybody ever heard me tell a story about fish? Okay, there are a few folk who heard the fish story. I can do this really fast. Who here has heard the idea that if you give a person a fish, they can eat for one meal, but if you teach them how to fish, they can eat for a lifetime? Who's ever heard that?
Cliche.
Whoever believed that was true?
Partly.
True. Who thought it was profound? Who thought it was deep? I said, let me try something slightly different on this. What was a ham sandwich? Okay, now it's the roast beef. Roast beef. Y'all will eat ham. Let's do a roast beef sandwich. Suppose I told you, give a person a roast beef sandwich, they'll eat for one sandwich. And teach them how to make roast beef sandwiches they'll eat for a lifetime.
Makes no sense.
It
makes no sense.
Why does that make no sense?
Because where are they going to get the roast beef from?
Well, why did the fish story make sense to people for so
It's
long?
The same thing. If they don't have a fishing pole, who's going to buy the fishing pole?
Okay. So here it is. That what is missing on the roast beef story is access to capital. Right. You don't have raw materials for the roast beef sandwich. You don't have access to the machinery that you need for the roast beef sandwich. And you know why people can get away with telling that story for fish for such a long time without being questioned much? It's because fishing and water is the closest we have to what is left of the commons. Think about that. In other words, it's the closest we have left. And I'm saying closest left because it's not in the commons anymore like it used to be, because there are too many people that can tell you about whole waterfront areas that are fenced off where people have to have permission because someone owns it. There are boats and stuff that someone owns that you can't use. There's equipment that you need that you can't use. So here's a story that was basically hadn't been true since hunting and gathering days that we're using as a model of how to construct and analyze society. And it has been used to blame the victim over and over again, because in a country like America, where education is readily available, but where access to the means of production is not readily available, you want to tell people that if you're poor, it's because you haven't availed yourself to get a good education. You didn't learn how to fish. As opposed to saying, if you're poor, it's because the banking structures in this country make your access to credit or have access to finance or damn near impossible. I don't care how much you know. That could have been what you would tell somebody, right? But that's not what people get told. They get told something about education connected with some fishy fish story. So remember, next time you hear that, to tell them, well, try roast beef. I don't like fish. And people say, oh, that doesn't work. So this, again, this idea of creating opportunities for people to be productive. That's why I think that the reparations argument in this country needs to be couched in a discussion around productivity rather than in a discussion around consumption. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yes. Now, what would happen if our consumption capacity was greatly increased quickly? Suppose I gave out a check for $150,000 to every black man, woman, and child in America. $150,000 each. What would happen?
Spend it all.
You eventually end up right.
Who said Cadillac? Please. I used to tell people, I said, that's a Nike and Cadillac solution. Because Cadillac would come out with some brand new model. They would call it the Liberation Mobile.
It would have red, black, and green spinners on the tires. On the twin, red, black, and green thing. And the suckers would keep on rolling every time you get to the corner. And it'd say freedom in the headlights across the back. And it would only cost like $75,000. And you'd have half your money left to go and buy some sneakers and stuff. You had this big bump right quick. And they would tell you how much you deserve this. Mm-hmm.
It's like, you deserve it. You deserve a new liberation mobile.
And we deserve getting all your money back. So in a consumer society, we're not going to consume ourselves to reparation. So there was the article in Yes Magazine recently that talked about reparation. And someone was supporting, you know, the idea. And the idea was, well, you know, of course people should do anything they want to with their money, because if they got 40 acres and a mule, they'd be able to do it. 40 acres and a mule was a production unit. It was not a consumption unit. It wasn't something that people were asking for and saying was connected with how they thought they would be free. The 40 acres and a mule discussion came out of 4 days of meetings between some African-American leaders in South Carolina and these union generals, where they talked about this. This is how we're going to help people become productive. It was not how we're going to help people become consumers. And right now, even in a situation where a lot of people would be simply called upon to mortgage the 40 acres, and use the money off of that, and the banks would be in possession of all this land again in a period of time. So it's not even about the land. And given, again, these oppressive financial structures are pervasive. They're all over the place. We have to be very, very careful from them, because there has been a system constructed to do what the system does. So on the one hand, we get upset. But I want to say something else about that privileged layer of people, because we're getting upset about the fact that, you know, it's like there's some bad apples or some evil bankers and stuff. No, the system is set up to do what it's doing. But there's a problem. When we have that layer, that buffer layer of privilege, what happens to them when there's an economic crisis?
They're
first to go. They're not
exactly the first.
They go. Now, they're not necessarily the first to go. They get hurt too, because while the owners are protecting their title and their ownership and their rights to everything, they will indeed sacrifice any and everything else, including them. Which means that ultimately, the capacity of this oppressive system to last forever is not there. Because ultimately, they will wear out the protective barrier, that level of people getting privileges, and the other folk will have one or two attitudes to it. One is, you didn't act like that before you lost your house. That's one of the things that some folk will do. It's happened, I've heard it. Or they'll say, come on over here and help us fight this fight. And you know, I got some stuff to talk to you about later, about some stuff you might have been able to see earlier, back when you were benefiting from this, but now that you don't anymore, let's build a fight. Yeah. My own inclination is I like to build fights. So I'm mainly concerned about finding out who's gonna be on my side in the fight. And I'm not going to first tell them how bad they used to be before I let them come on my side. That's just my own personal. Other people will do different things with that, you know? But my own orientation is, come on over, let's build this fight. And we have to build a fight, because ultimately these questions are all about power. Mm-hmm. The whole issue of reparations is about power. It's about who it is, how do you construct the power. How long has the discussion on reparations been going, or reparation for slavery, been going on in this country? Yeah, for the entire time since people started thinking about the ending of slavery, probably preceded it actually ending, that there were people considering, well, what will we do with the freed slaves? And all kind of crazy ideas would come up. Some was expatriationists, send them to Liberia and Sierra Leone. Let's set aside some special area for them, you know. Let's send them all to Haiti. I mean, there were different ideas and schemes that came up. But ultimately, this discussion has been going on a long time. Why hadn't there been any motion on it?
Racism.
Racism is certainly a factor in it, and it's connected, but ultimately, just like why there isn't any motion on anything else, it's a question of power. Right. Because at the point you can build power to do it, you can get it done. So it's really complex as we think about social movements, and a lot of times we have some fairly naive ideas about social movements, as though they're kind of the product of individual genius or great ideas,
Some people think, for instance, that the civil rights movement of the 60s was successful because this was the first time black folks stood up for their rights. Let me tell you something. Our people have been standing up for their rights ever since they knew how to stand up, right? Harriet Tubman knew something about standing up for your rights. Then Mark Vesey, Nat Turner, they knew something about standing up for your rights. People standing up for their rights when they were the Red Summer of 1919 and these returning soldiers coming back into Detroit and Chicago and New York and Washington, D.C., came back and stood up. They stood up. But the reason why some things were successful in the 1960s that weren't then was that there was a shift in power. And what was this shift based on?
Generational?
No, it was a cold,
access to the lost
Cold War. Mm-hmm.
Try the Cold War. Did you know that by the time that the countries of Asia, Africa, and Latin America were fighting for their independence from European colonization and domination, and there existed another pole in the world, and this one was what had grown out of Russia in 1917, that there was this new threat and challenge that these countries of Asia, Africa, and Latin America that we cannot suppress all at the same time. The French were getting their ass kicked in Vietnam and got kicked out of there. The United States went in and tried to replace them, got their butts kicked. In Korea, the United States sent in its military power and found out there's a whole bunch of Chinese on the other side of the Yalu River, and it would come up there and confront them. And folks, and the British were getting kicked out of India. We have to understand we live in a world. You know, if we lock focus just on what's going on in the United States, even in thinking about reparations, we won't go very far. So we have to realize that in the world today, that situation of the Cold War is what led the federal government to switch sides. So in 1898, in Wilmington, North Carolina, there was a military coup. Right-wingers, brown shirts in Wilmington, took over the government from an elected integrated fusion government that had dominated eastern North Carolina politics. Poor white farmers and African Americans got together, built a political thing together. The white racist representatives, the old owning class and stuff, rose up, made use of racism. An article some brother wrote about whether or not white women like black men, was quite frankly the precipitation for the Wilmington Race Riot in the 1898s. But the federal government did not intercede. When folks said, look, y'all need to come in here as an elected government getting ready to be overthrown, this is a coup, the federal government didn't have anything to do with it. In 1919 in Elaine, Arkansas, when tenant farmers got together fighting for their rights, and there was a stroke, Elaine, which is in the western part of the Mississippi Delta. This is the Mississippi Delta on the other side of the river, Elaine, Arkansas. These folks got together, and a fight broke out. Some people were shot after they had attacked, you know, a peaceful meeting of some Southern Tenant Farmers Unit. So this was the first time the U.S. had ever sent a military expedition into a black community with machine guns to devastate that community. And this is part of the history of Elaine, Arkansas. And then after that, after shooting up the town and killing a bunch of black folk, they ended up putting a bunch of black folk on trial for murder. But this was out of Camp Robinson in Little Rock, downtown Little Rock. So this is part of the history of what we have. The federal government was on the other side. Then in the 1960s, in Little Rock, Little Rock's got to be pivotal here. In 1957, what happened in Little Rock? Anybody remember? In 1957, President Eisenhower sent the 101st Airborne out of Fort Campbell, Kentucky, into Little Rock to allow 9 black children to go to the high school I graduated from in 1967. That happened in 1957. I went there in 1964 and graduated in 67. So federal government switched sides. And why they do it? Because John Foster Dulles and others told them, look, we're being embarrassed all around the world because every time we're in one of these meetings, one of these international meetings where we're trying to broker who these folk are going to align with. They keep raising up how racist America is. And so we're talking to black folk from Asia and dark folk from, black folk from Africa and dark folk from Asia, Latin America. And when they see how racist we are, we're being embarrassed. And they're heading for the soap. So we need to do something different. So the United States comes in and makes a deal over here with existing civil rights organizations like the NAACP and others. And basically the deal was, if you support us on international questions, so you support us on Palestine, you support us on anti-communism and opposition to Russia, you help root out the communists in your own midst, You turn over Paul Robeson to us. You kick W.E.B. Du Bois out. This was the deal that we'll support you on civil rights. And that was the deal that got made. This is the deal under which, to some extent, we are still living today. Mm-hmm. If you look at the Congressional Black Caucus's voting record on Palestine, you will see this is the deal under which we are still living in part today. So we have to have an enlightened view of how it is we're going to build the power necessary to advance a discussion around reparations to move toward the creation of opportunities to be productive. And that's kind of where I want to leave our discussion. I hope there's enough been said about reparations and linking it into the context of how it fits in a world of privilege, how it fits into a world where surplus is appropriated, how it fits in the world where the ownership structure is backed up by violent apparatus that have to be done, and how we have to build the power to do something differently. There are two examples of that that I can mention in terms of some local work that you know we can have more questions about, and I really want us to have a really free-form discussion for the rest of our time together. One is we and the Southern Grassroots Economies Project is looking to do work across the South in these communities that were disadvantaged and damaged by that slave system that we described. Are building something we're calling the Southern Reparations Loan Fund. And we're not building it by going to the federal government arguing that the Congress should pass a law passing the tax bill. We're building it by telling people the story of slavery and its relationship to the South, and we're calling upon people, including people with wealth and access to resources, to look. You know, we need to break this cloudy relationship between wealth and hard work, which assumes that people who are rich work hard. We know way too many people work hard all their lives, don't have nothing for it, and understand that there was wealth that was stolen, and the people from whom it was stolen are still there and in need of access to this so that they can be productive themselves and do things for themselves, and how about bringing some of it back? So right now, there are organizations like Resource Generation that are involved in trying to figure out ways to help resource this. There are other people and individuals and foundations and such. And at some point, we begin to build collectively more and more power to be able to affect this as we see the concrete effect of it in communities. So right now, in Greensboro, North Carolina, we're building a grocery store in a neighborhood that was a food desert. And we had to do it in gathering some wealth together. We got $250,000 from the city, in addition to loans available from existing cooperative development loan funds, in addition to owner loans from individuals in the community, including black and white individuals who will join the thing and recognize that it is the right thing to do. The county government just went through a vote where they were too stupid to realize it was the right thing to do it and denied some funds, but we'll get other funds. A large church just made $40,000, a large African-American church in Greensboro just made $40,000 available to the effort. So we raised over $1.5 million of the $2 million. We're well on our way toward identifying and raising the other half that we'll need. It's called a Renaissance Cooperative Grocery Store, and it leads people in the community to be able to walk around with these t-shirts to say what? I own this store. These are people, there are hundreds of people now in that community that have created a new opportunity to create 32 jobs in a food desert. It is relying on these principles. The three principles of the Reparation Loan Fund are radical inclusivity, which is to say we're going to make funds available to people who banks and other financial structures would normally not lend to, wouldn't pay any attention to at all. The other principle is non-extractive finance, which is to say we're making these funds available under the condition that you will not lose your home if you don't get paid back, that you will be able to build a sustainable business, and these funds will be repaid out of the sustainable increase in productivity that you will be able to have within your community. And lastly, on the principle of maximizing community benefit, which is just as simple a principle as maximizing profit, except it is a more rational one. Isn't it better to want to maximize how much you help your community rather than maximize this accounting figure, which is what's left over after you've done everything else? And those are the three principles of it: non-extractive finance, radical inclusivity, and maximizing community benefit for the Southern Reparations Loan Fund, one of the projects that's connected with it is the RCC grocery store. And I'm tired, y'all. Y'all did good. Let me get through it. So we got some time for some questions, and they might be irrelevant or whatever they are. Let it roll. Let's talk. Yes, brother.
Oh, I just had a question in terms of thinking about the recent tragedy in South Carolina and the discussion that's come up about, you know, talking about the Confederate flag. Is that another example of focusing on the symbolism rather than the material? In other words, when you're talking about what about the cow? In other words, that people, you know, worrying about the flag as opposed to the deaths of these people, about the economic inequality in South Carolina, voter disenfranchisement, all the sort of concrete issues, and that the flag is more of a distraction.
I absolutely, you know what, I'm glad you said that instead of me. I absolutely agree that we really do have to stay focused. And you know, if as so many young folks are saying now, and I fully agree with them, it's like the whole damn system is guilty as hell, then you got to understand that the role of individuals in that system is one thing, but you got to keep your eye on that system. In other words, so if you rooted out every individual who might do something stupid like that, then you still have a whole damn system that's guilty as hell. And I don't advocate for a minute going light on whoever that fool was who did that.
Right.
But I do say that we have to lock our focus not on being distracted. To me, an additional distraction, and somebody may get mad at me for this, is like, I don't care who the head of the Spokane, Washington NAACP job is.
Sure.
I personally don't care. I really don't care. And that's between her and her mom and daddy and some other people up there in Spokane. They should decide if she's a good leader or a bad leader and probably do something based on that. The NAACP has been confused for a long time. I told you about
From its founding.
I told you about the deal that it made, kicking out W.B. Du Bois and Alvin Robinson and all them other folks. So I kind of don't care.
Right.
But it's so easy for folks to get distracted and kind of, oh, this is the, it's like, I don't know. I mean, I don't spend any time thinking about, you know, whether or not she was really black or pretending to be. And in fact, most white folk are absolutely unwilling to give up any privilege and claim to be black. So I ain't mad at her, but, you know, yeah, focus. It's important for us to stay focused. The tragedy in South Carolina is a very egregious thing that people should pay attention to. They should call out the existing structures, the racist structures of the mass media and the education system for having treated this so differently than they would other things. Y'all know if a black dude had gone in and shot up a white church, they would have grabbed everybody and his family and locked them up. They would have been asking who else knew him. They would have been talking about, was this some larger part of some larger plot that they were going to root out? They'd have been waterboarding half the people in his neighborhood to find out the depth of the information. They didn't do this. They put a bulletproof vest on this dude so nobody heard him. You know, if you think, I mean, the juxtaposed pictures that I've seen of Eric Garner getting choked to death for selling Lucy's, and this dude with a bulletproof vest being, you know, there's something about how the system interacts with this that is worth us paying attention to, but at the same time, we can't lose focus on an oppressive system rooted in structures of ownership that are onerous, that will continue to reproduce these class problems that we face every day, unless we identify them and root them out. And that's you know, focus is very important. I'm sorry, Ryan.
Can you talk about the structure of ownership of the grocery store? Is it a worker self-directed enterprise? How are decisions being made?
The grocery store will open in early 2016. So it is not a worker cooperative, it is a cooperative structure. It is owned by that community. The community elects a board. The board will hire a manager. The manager will have certain hiring responsibilities as it relates to the other stuff, but the board has set policies including the base rate of wages, so that the weight and the rate of wage for the manager, so that the people will start off making $10 an hour rather than something close to the minimum wage, because the community interest in setting up the store would both create good jobs as well as access to a broader range of food. The reason it's not a worker co-op, any workers yet. In other words, there's going to be 32 jobs there. But if you were to talk about this is going to be a democratic structure that's going to be democratically owned by its members, we couldn't have put together 32 workers who were going to stay together for 3 years that we've spent building this in order to later on be the democratic entity that's going to run the store. We could put together that out of a community structure. So it's community-owned, cooperative store, democratically owned and democratically governed, and open to, when the workers get there, they can form a union if they would like, or they can go ahead and organize themselves as an ownership unit, and we can talk about redoing the bylaws to create a separate ownership category for the store employees. That is something that would be possible once they exist. But right now, there aren't any workers yet, so it's not a worker co-op. And it's not even a dual co-op, because for it to be a dual co-op, there has to be some workers.
How do you see the strategy of demanding reparations as connecting to the movements to end police violence and to end gentrification and other forces that are affecting marginalized communities?
Well, the work I'm trying to figure out how to do around reparations has to do with, again, creating development entities. These development entities would engage in communities, maximizing benefit and developing. It would allow for there to remain a body of work that has to do with how to deal with this repressive violent apparatus is also a structure. So it's a piece of work, and it's not the entire piece of work. Up there on the board where I have the lower section, resist, advocate, and do for ourselves, this is work that's firmly rooted in the do for ourselves part. We have for a long time done a lot of work in the resistance area, but quite frankly, you can resist a whole lot of things about existing power and have to continue to resist it year after year after year because it's still in power and you don't have any. You can advocate, which is to try to direct existing power and resources to help you. And you have to do that year after year after year because they, again, maintain the bulk of their resources, they maintain their power, and you're just kind of directing it. So at the point that we are doing for ourselves, we create new power within communities. And that this power that we create can fold over into helping to strengthen our resistance work, helping to strengthen our advocacy work, but at the same time be the core of building the new that will replace some of the old when we're found, when it either collapses of its own weight, mm-hmm. which some parts of it are perfectly capable of doing, or it is displaced by our righteous struggles against it because it is the evil that it is. I didn't mean to say that.
You're right. Okay, so I really like this idea, and I understand that it's not looking for government funding or backing, but are there any examples of reparations to other groups who have been wronged that this is being modeled after, or any like that you see that are good, you know, to take some from?
In the international arena, there are other kinds of reparations discussions that are rooted in the idea of development. I'm not as familiar with that as I might be. Most of the reparations discussions I've heard and read and studied have been about domestic stuff, and a lot of them have been ambiguous on the question of whether or not this is going to move toward facilitating production or enhancing consumption. They've been just kind of ambiguous. You can read the Ta-Nehisi Coates article over and over again, and you won't know what he thinks it is that people ought to do with the money or how to make it available. And more than that, it strikes me as being a little dead end as it relates to how you're going to even get it. Because that political argument, when people are around arguing, people make this argument around the undeserving poor, which is politicians, I will assure you, will go out of their way to make sure they don't even accidentally do anything that might benefit the undeserving poor. And by that, they mean pretty much the deserving poor or white women who are widows of military veterans and their orphans and nobody else I can think of. I mean, the deserving poor, the really, really mad. Everybody else is undeserving poor, right? And you don't want to actively help the undeserving poor. Nobody worries about helping the undeserving rich. Now, I'm not claiming that everybody who is rich, you know, was lazy and never did any work. I'm sure there might be some of them somewhere to pull themselves up by the bootstraps, but the main indicator for being wealthy is to have wealthy parents. And where did the wealthy parents get their wealth from? Most of them got their wealth from their wealthy parents, all right? And where did they get it? From slavery and theft. So much of the wealth that exists in these communities that allow these wealthy developers to be the ones in the community who have access to the banking and access to the finance so that they can sponsor the shopping center or new factory, whichever the developer wants to build, is something that it just is undeserving. And so, but the political fight is one that you have to build a broad struggle around people to engage in. And so it's figuring that out. I'm not against, particularly not at the local level. I really think we need to argue hard at the local level, where again, we know a lot more about building local political power than we do national political power. National political power is just so confusing to me, because it's not like I think either the Democrats or the Republicans who are gonna get vetted for these national offices are likely to have our interests broadly in mind. We can probably elect some local folks. That's what we did in Greensboro. Part of the city council devoted to support us, a base of this community was organized to fight a land to fill, and growing out of that fight, they re-elected half the city council. And so now they have a city council, half of whom they were responsible for getting in office. So now when it comes, like, we back to you, we want this grocery store we've been needing since 1998, folks say, oh, okay, because they know there's political power there. So that we need to build local political power. It is the right thing to do for our local government and our local taxes to come back into our communities to help us build up stuff. This is the part of that process. I'm just saying that it strikes me that running to the national government right now, as Commerce, you know, has been asking for some discussion in the Congress on reparations for, what, 30, 40 years now? Mm-hmm. And no one's bothered to take it up. That you put a lot of energy into that and spinning wheels, and I think that there's some things that can be built right now, and that we need to build all of the examples, all of the models of powerful local things that we can do, because we never can tell when some crisis is not going to come up, and we will be sought out as the experts who know something different to be done. And it can be a fairly small group at first, but we will be the examples that other people will be flocking to the meeting.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so I just want to say thank you for giving me, and I think a lot of us, so much to chew on. I have a lot to process from this, but I'm part of the Coalition for Black Struggle here in Detroit, mm-hmm. and actually on Tuesday we're going to be starting something called Black Talk Tuesdays, and our first conversation is going to be on reparations, focusing on under the larger picture of anti-blackness and our own liberation, self-determination. What does the case for reparations look like today? Haven't we discussed it? So I'll be bringing this back to the group. And for those that want to join in on the conversation, do we have a hashtag for it yet?
Hashtag Black Talk Tuesdays, hashtag BTT. And if y'all all want to follow either one of us, that's a better way to like link everyone into that conversation. Can I just give out my Twitter name real quick?
Go right on the board.
Yeah. What's up, y'all? I'm Dennis Black.
Yes, I just wanted to share that with everybody. Hoping to build a lot of conversation out of it. And I don't have a question so much as the thing I get stuck on, because I focus a lot on the international imperialistic issues. If we're moving towards creating more productivity on a local level or for ourselves, I don't know how we divorce that from, like, if we're producing the raw materials that we're creating might still be coming from mines in South Africa that are exploitative, or places in the, like, rubber from the Congo that's, so, yeah, I don't know if the issue is fully clear, but I'm just trying to sort out.
I hear you. There's a young man in this room who spent a lot of his life working on issues of trade and international things. Thinking about how is it that we set up fair relations with people who are producers of raw materials or producers even of consumer goods. Jonathan, you want to say something about that? This is Jonathan Rosenthal. He's the new executive director of the New Economies Coalition. I'm on his board, but
thanks for
he's our new leader. Go for it.
Well, I think it's a really tough issue. I think in the world of fair trade, we've had more success than we ever imagined possible 20, 30 years ago. And what we discovered is, if you take a step back to the wet ball of dirt level, we've totally failed. In that, we've been completely integrated into the system, and farmers are still stuck in supply chains where the vast majority of the value of your cup of coffee goes to Starbucks investors and not to the fair trade farmer or the co-op. So I think there's been tremendous advances. The main advance in that world, really, I think, has been that fair trade has allowed farmers to organize at a global level. And I think that even having to fight to take power in the fair trade system itself with well-intentioned white European and U.S. folks has been difficult, but there's been progress. So I think it's that organizing. So in terms of international supply chains, like manufacturing stuff, it's just a long struggle. And I think the best thing we can do is exactly what AMC is about, which is creating relationships and building trust across sectors. To me, that's the future, is multi-sector work and getting away from this little narrow slice. So I just do fair trade, so I don't worry about having an anti-oppression lens because it's about supply chains. Like, that's the world I've come from. So to me, that's not a very good answer, but I think it's about cross-sector building and keeping your eye on the prize, paraphrase that.